Welcome to WTNB Sports. Brian Russell alongside Chris Woods and Danny Bradley. Gentlemen, how are we?
Well, after a football game that just finished not too long ago, it's good.
Yeah.
It's a good.
For those of you watching, you'll figure out what we mean like later on, the Green Bay-Seattle game. That was a crazy finish. Just real quick, WTNB Sports brought to you by XLIX of Cleveland. Thank you to them, 1107 South Lee Highway. And as you also see, LED Gear, we want to thank them. Ed Jacobs and Associates, Logan Thompson Law Office, Trace Hermanos, Keystone Solutions IT, Kyle Motors, RPM Transport, and Marco's Pizza. Thank you to all of them for making this show possible. All right, guys, on this show, we're going to have some basketball highlights. Bradley paying a little visit to Walker Valley Friday night. And then we don't have the highlights from the Cleveland-Walker Valley wrestling match, but we can talk a little bit about that. You know, of course, Cleveland getting a big win to stay number two behind Bradley for the state rankings.
Oh, and then Bradley also, too, making a statement is they took the number four team, Soddy Daisy, to the woodshed.
Right.
So two big wins here locally. Walker Valley, like you said, losing to Cleveland. Had, I think, three winners in that one, but that was it. Mm-hmm. Cleveland starting to try to build a little bit of momentum after that loss to Bradley. So it's going to be some good wrestling in this area before it's all said and done. Talking about the basketball games, you know, you couldn't say a barn burner in the first one because the guys wouldn't have had a place to play. Both of them were barn burners.
Yeah, as you're going to see, the girls, they went into overtime. So let's go ahead and get right into those highlights, Jay, and we'll take a look at those. Of course, the game being played at the Corral. Chris, Walker Valley and Bradley would both come out on fire early.
Yeah, they did. They came out and scored a couple buckets, and then it was pretty consistent, the scoring throughout the game, with Bradley Central, as you'll see in the highlights, really turning it on towards the end.
Yeah, there you go. You see Haley Hughes with a couple quick layups for Bradley. She ended up having 22 points in the game, so a huge night for her. And you see Walker Valley answering with a nice drive inside. And Danny, Walker Valley, very tough to beat at home. The Corral is not an easy place to play.
Oh, it's not. And I mean, this was a standing room only crowd for both the girls and the boys game, for both of them. Bradley, defensive pressure the entire time. But, you know, both these teams in this game last Friday night playing for first place. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot on the line, not just the bragging rights, not just for the win, but for first place in the district. And it went, like you said, to overtime to decide it.
Great pass there for the layup.
And there's Kat Alomar for Walker Valley. We apologize, we don't have more Walker Valley names, but unfortunately their roster wasn't updated on their website. But we're going to correct that before next week. We'll get a hold of the coach and we'll get an updated roster. Like we said, this one goes was close all night, back and forth, back and forth. Coach Jason Reuter, of course, this year playing without the Twin Towers, so a little bit of adjustment for Bradley.
Yeah, but he's got some talented freshmen and sophomores that are stepping up.
Yeah, go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, so I was just wanting to point out Kat Alomar's ball skills there. And, you know, you said she'd scored 25 points, and I was wondering if you'd scored 25 points in your basketball career.
No. No, my son has, but not me. But no, I mean, Kat Alomar, yeah, she really handles the ball well, moves around.
Is there three ball there?
Yeah. And there you see number 23, that's Ryan Howard from Bradley. Of course, she transferred in from East Hamilton at the start of the year. So big pickup for Jason Reuter's club.
Oh, and she is a freshman as well. So mm-hmm. She transferred over from, I believe, the middle school program.
Yeah, she played last year varsity as an eighth grader.
Yep.
That tells you anything about her skills. And Ryan Howard for Bradley also had 24 points. Jacqueline Griffin for Walker Valley had 13. And there you go, see game 49-48 in the fourth quarter, 1:49 left, Alomar dishes. And there's the steal by Ryan Howard. An easy lay-in for Bradley. It's 51-49 with a minute 22 left.
Alomar with a long shot outside, no good, but rebound up and in for the offensive rebound put back. Tying the ball game.
You see Bradley with, chances to win there towards the end of the game.
So they go two up. Walker Valley
Yeah, three ball to tie it at 56 late in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, huge three-point shot right there. Then Walker Valley.
Excuse me, that was an overtime.
Yeah, that was an overtime, and then just falls short.
I thought our kids found resolve. We talk about having that resolve. When things don't go well, find a way to win. I thought our kids, they gutted it out. We could have folded. We're in their house, crosstown rival. You can see that the timeouts were important, the runs they made on us. I think this was just pure pride on the line. I think our kids just played just a little bit better than Walker Valley did.
So, you see there, the Bearettes of Bradley, bear down, pardon the pun.
that was bad.
Overtime win, but a great win for Jason Reuter and the Bearettes. Of course, it's not over with yet.
No.
I was just going to say Bradley Central outscored Walker Valley 14-11 in overtime to win 65-61. So good win, good game by both teams. Back and forth game the entire time. We know Bradley Central got out to that 20-11 lead after the first quarter, but Walker Valley hung tough the entire game. Just couldn't pull it out at the end.
Yeah, and Walker Valley, like I said, dropping to 5-2, which puts them really third place at the time being, because Bradley and Cleveland Blue Raiders, I don't think they call themselves the Lady Blue Raiders, do they? Just Cleveland Blue Raiders.
Blue Raiders.
So both Bradley and Cleveland girls teams at 6-1 in the division. Mm-hmm. So they play each other January the 23rd. Cleveland and Walker Valley play each other then January 30th. So that's your first, second, and third place teams in the district. I mean, the other ones, I don't believe there's a chance for any of the others to even come in and make it that third place team.
Yeah.
Unless something just drastic happens bad with the, with one of those three teams. But all three of them with winning records. But Bradley right now in control of their own destiny, 6-1 in the district. Only have to get by Cleveland because it doesn't matter what else happens because of the tiebreaker situation with Walker Valley, defeating them. They've got that in their corner. So
right. And I want to commend the nice-looking crowd there Friday night, despite the chilly conditions and that huge snow we had that forced school to be canceled Friday.
That was sarcasm.
That was sarcasm, in case you missed that, from being from Pennsylvania. I'm sorry, I just have to laugh every time it snows down here and everybody freaks out. But good crowd. So I'll tell you what, we're going to take a short break right now. When we come back, we'll have the highlights from the boys' game, Bradley at Walker Valley. So stick with us on WTMB Sports.
My name is Preston West, owner of Keystone Solutions. We specialize in helping small businesses with their IT needs, whether it's hardware or software or computer issues, servers, networks, kind of anything that's under the IT umbrella is what we take care of. We want to be it, if you will. When people are looking for IT help, we want to be the person that you call and the person that you think of first.
Flooring Center of Cleveland, Tennessee has been providing our community with personal service and competitive pricing for over 15 years. Carpet, hardwood, tile, ceramic, and vinyl options are all in stock with plenty of top quality brand names. From 8 to 5 Monday through Friday and 9 to 2 on Saturday, our knowledgeable staff are here to help you with your flooring decisions. Come on down and visit our showroom today.
My name is Hannah Davis, and I am the founder of the Body by Hannah fitness brand, as well as the fitness expert for Cosmopolitan magazine. When you work with me, you can rest assured that I'm going to take very good care of you. I've worked with clientele of all different fitness levels, all different ages. I'm able to meet a client where he or she is fitness level wise and really help them grow and take them to the next level. When you choose Body by Hannah, you're choosing experience. You're getting a trainer that is highly certified and highly qualified. And you can contact me at bodybyhannah.com. If you don't use it, you lose it. So I really want to encourage everybody to get out there and get fit for a long, quality life.
Welcome back to WTNB Sports. Brian Russell alongside Danny Bradley. Once again, we're brought to you by XLIX of Cleveland and LED Gear. And guys,
Chris Woods is over there on that side.
What did I say?
Danny Bradley.
Oh, I thought I said Chris too. I'm sorry. I was like, oh, hey,
I'll
Chris.
I'll take it.
I'm sorry. That's my brother-in-law. It's okay. I leave him out sometimes.
Oh, we're not related.
We talked about the Bradley-Walker Valley girls game, how that was a good game. The next game of the night, fans really got their money's worth because they saw another great game. Chris, why don't you talk a little bit about that before we see the highlights?
Yeah, the Bears and Mustangs, of course, in the boys' game. Like the girls' game, a little bit lower scoring game, a little bit more defense. But it did come down to the fourth quarter where Bradley Central actually took the lead and pulled away a little bit.
You don't see that very often. The boys scoring less points than the girls, do you?
They scored significantly less
than the girls. Doesn't usually happen, but it did. So, Jay, let's go ahead and roll those highlights, and we're back out at the corral. No drone shots. Of course, we have a drone cam. A little bit too low of a ceiling.
It can go.
Jay's shaking his head. So
that sounds like a challenge.
Yeah, we may have drone highlights next week. Let's wait. So you'll see Bradley come out and try to get things going early. And there's number 12, Tucker Maroon, with the three ball. And Walker Valley coming back down the court. Kind of a back and forth game early. Tempo was up there, but again, not a lot of points being scored.
A good ball movement for the three ball there.
Clark with the little runner, the little floater.
There's a good answer.
Clark really runs that offense extremely well. That was cold right there. Cole Kirkland threw off. Sports star for Bradley in football and basketball.
Yeah, and you can see Walker Valley picks
up 21-7. And it really was the most important game for the boys' action. Both teams, I think, took a 3-point shot. And neither team was hitting at a bad pace, but neither team was hitting at a great pace either from 3-point. And you see there, and this Walker Valley from the outside sets up the fast break for Bradley, and they all take advantage with the drive there.
Turnover, Bradley on the break there with the finish, number 23.
Number 23 was Bradley McCurdy.
So you see a little different from the highlights from the first half. Bradley seemed to be shooting a lot of threes in the first half, and they did a lot of slashing and passing in the second half.
Well, Walker Valley tried to turn up the defense, but just
good entry pass there, 23.
Yeah, you get the ball down that low in the paint, it's going to be hard to stop. So we Bradley up 45-44, now 46-44 with the mate free throw. And let's listen to Coach Chuck Clark.
Less than I expected that we would in the first three quarters, and then with about 4 minutes to go in the third quarter, we started picking it up, putting more pressure on, and we started playing a little bit more Bradley basketball.
So Bradley able to hold on for the 49-44 win, and you heard Coach Chuck Clark there talking about the victory and what it means to his ball club. Missed some excitement earlier in the game, Danny, wasn't there somebody thrown out for hitting the official in the face with a basketball?
Oh, it was one of the little foam basketballs, yeah. I think they threw out. And
somebody didn't like a call. Yeah.
Yeah. But
that's not a foul.
It was an accident, I'm sure. So, so Bradley now, we talked about earlier, the Bearettes taking on the Blue Raiders January 23rd. That sets up the Bradley Bears to take down the district leaders, the Cleveland Blue Raiders. Picked number one. They are number one. They're still undefeated in district. So,
and Bradley 6-1 in district, right?
Yeah. Like the Bradley Cleveland game needed anything else on the line to make it more exciting.
So, you know, it's just that Cleveland Bradley game, Cleveland Middle School.
Yeah, because they've already played at Bradley, right?
Yeah. So, I believe it is.
No. The first game was at Cleveland Middle.
Yeah.
So they will be at Bradley. Yeah.
Bradley. Okay. Yep. So there'll be plenty of room.
Yes.
Yep. Just a little bit more on the game. Daniel Clark led Bradley Central with 14. Cole Copeland had 10, and Tucker Maroon had 10 also.
Yeah. So, great game by the Bears. You know, and the Mustangs obviously have nothing to be ashamed of. So. Yep. Of course, when we get down to district, anything can happen when we get that district tournament. So, yep. And that will be at Udawah this year, by the way.
Yeah. And for Walker Valley, just to follow up on the stats, Bryce Nunley had 19, Josh Jones had 14 to lead Walker Valley.
And Josh Jones has had a couple, three, four good games in a row here. He scored 23 twice last week in a couple of Walker Valley games. And then tonight, or the game we're talking about here tonight, doing really well. Him and Bryce, though. Seems like the brunt of the work's falling on the shoulders of those two. If Walker Valley can get some of the spreading, the scoring spread out, you know, any of these teams can be dangerous. Cleveland right now, stronghold on number one without a shadow of a doubt.
Yep.
We know going up until the quarterfinal, you know, whatever for the state, you take the top two teams. It could be Bradley, it could be Walker Valley, it could be, you know.
Could be Udawah,
But Cleveland right now, without a shadow of a doubt, stronghold on number one. So.
Yeah, and Nunley and Jones for Walker Valley, another couple of two sports stars. You know, we talked about Cole for Bradley, you know, Cole Copeland, you know, football and basketball. But, of course, these two also play football for Walker Valley. So, again, you're just seeing the range of athleticism that these kids have nowadays, where back when we were probably kids, you start in one sport and that was it. But now they seem to excel in everything. So.
Although it seems like everyone says you need to pick one. And
I don't know. These kids prove otherwise. So I tell you what, let's go ahead and take a break. And when we come back, we'll have more WTNB Sports. We'll talk a little bit of wrestling. We'll talk a little bit of bowling. We still got to recap the national championship game for college. None of us got that game right, by the way. And we'll also set up the Super Bowl because right now, Seattle has punched their ticket, and from everything we've seen so far, it looks like the Patriots are on their way. So stick with us on WTNB Sports.
Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave over the land of the free? And the home of the brave. That's what I'm talking about. That's a winner. He's the loser.
Hi, I'm Samantha Young, managing editor of Southeast Crossroads Magazine, our area's newest and free monthly publication. We focus on events, people, and culture of our area. Pick one up at over 200 locations in Bradley, Hamilton, McMinn, Meigs, and Polk counties, or check us out online at southeastcrossroads.com.
My name is Dr. Chris Palmer, and I think we at Tennessee Valley Bone and Joint stack up very well to the things that you would otherwise have to travel maybe to Knoxville or Chattanooga or even to Atlanta to get that same good combination of training and experience.
Are you like millions of Americans who are struggling to pay your bills? Do you have crippling debt? Are your wages being garnished? Are your bank accounts being levied? You need a solution. You need Pollo Loco. Get the best Pollo Loco in town at Tres Hermanos. Pollo Loco, the real solution.
Cleveland Tire Center is ready to help you in any way that it can. We're one of the largest Bridgestone and Firestone tire dealers in the area, and we have plenty of other brands for you to choose from. Our loyal mechanics have been with us for years, and each one works to ensure that you receive the timely performance you need. If you're looking for quality hometown service, then you found the right place. Save yourself some valuable time and money by doing the right thing the first time and stopping by our service center.
Here I am, living every doughball's dream. I'm the next Marco's Pizza Crust. I'm fresh, made by hand today. Now, my massage. Whew, that's nice.
Our ingredients speak for themselves. Marco's, authentic Italian pizza.
Welcome back to WTNB Sports. Brian Russell alongside Chris Woods. Remembered you that time, and Danny Bradley. So real quick, let's go ahead and throw up a graphic of the upcoming schedule for this week. So Jay, if you'll throw that up. There you go. You'll see, and this is sponsored by ARW Wrestling. You know, those clowns over there that ruined our Christmas parade show. We're still working with them on that. We'll get that a little bit later. High school basketball, Tuesday, January 20th. Danny, Walker Valley goes to Ottawa. Not an easy place to play down there at the barn.
No, not at the barn. And the Owls, not necessarily as high-flying as they have been as of late, but they're always tough at the barn. So that's going to be a tough one for the Mustangs, trying to bounce back, both the boys and the girls losing to Bradley Friday night. So
and that's Tuesday, January 20th again. Then Friday, January 23rd. Man, like your Friday night needed to be any more exciting. Cleveland at Bradley Central. Chris, these two get together, it doesn't matter the sport.
Well, yeah, and Danny talked about it. The district championship is on the line, too, or at least the leader in the district, with one being undefeated and then Bradley Central being 6-1 currently in basketball.
Right. Then we'll get into the next week, Tuesday, January 27th. The Mustangs will go back into the Bears' den looking for some revenge in high school basketball. The girls and boys will be that Tuesday, January 27th. Of course, you just saw the highlights, two close games, so I wouldn't expect anything different. And then the following Friday, January 30th, Walker Valley will go to Cleveland Middle School to play the Cleveland Blue Raiders. Of course, why at the middle school? Because Cleveland is still without a gym.
It's getting closer.
It's getting closer.
So,
drive by there every day. You can see the progress. So. Of course, then the district tournament will be at Ottawa this year. So a little bit of a drive. I mean, not bad. I mean, it's not driving all the way down to East Hamilton. No. So, you know, just driving down to Ottawa. You kind of easy to get off right there and get to the high school. And nice size gym down there. So
kind of easy to get to. And then when you get through the basketball game, just come back to Bradley County and, you know, do your eating and celebrating because – I'm positive. One of the Bradley County teams is going to come away as the champion. Yeah. Both boys and girls.
I would think so.
Those of you that have seen Danny's predictions from football, I mean, you
know that I'm right.
You could be right, yeah. That's what I'm trying to say, yeah. You're the Swami.
I'm just surprised he hasn't picked Ray County to go undefeated in basketball. Yeah, he's stuck with them in football. You know. Any early predictions for football? No, we won't actually for football this early. But there was some high school wrestling this week. Unfortunately, we don't have the highlights from that because the dates that were printed were a little off. But Cleveland did host Walker Valley in wrestling and came away with a 47-15 victory. And you know, like we said here on WTNB Sports, we're all about trying to get the kids' names out here, so bear with us. I'm gonna read through these names, and we'll get to some of the matches. We'll talk about them. Mm-hmm. At 106, Cody Matthews for Cleveland got a technical fall over Chandler Davis. 113, Jace Mullins for Cleveland got a big victory over there. 120, Zane Smith for Walker Valley won by forfeit. 126, Colton Landers for Cleveland pinned Robert Varner for Walker Valley. 132 was the match. I think we want to talk about this one. Chris Dabian of Cleveland was able to score a major decision over Joseph Munoz of Walker Valley, 19-7.
Well, and Chris, for Cleveland, Dabian, defending state champion, and number one in the state, Joseph Munoz, number six in the state, and good match there, finished by decision. So.
Yeah. Then at 138, Austin Gregory of Walker Valley was able to get the victory. 145, Ezra Taylor from Cleveland got the win. 152, Mikhail Gregory from Walker Valley got the win. 160, Aaron Oliver was able to pin his opponent. At 170, Jonathan Martin of Cleveland won. 182, Samuel Garcia was able to score a technical fall for Cleveland. 195, Riley Stevenson was able to get a decision over Brendan Hooker. And then at 220, Danny Rick Kennett, who of course, or Kennett, I'm sorry, for Walker Valley, was able to get a decision over John Gaither. And of course, Rick was the former center for Walker Valley's football. Unable to play football now, I believe, and is now wrestling, but an outstanding wrestler for Walker Valley.
Yeah, and in that one, too, that was a surprise for Cleveland from the loss standpoint, because Gaither is actually the number two ranked 220-pound wrestler in the state. Kennett was number three, so it wasn't much of a difference there, but a little bit of an upset if you're Cleveland.
Oh, yeah.
But for Walker Valley, Kennett, he's kind of on a roll now. He's won several matches here in the last few weeks, and maybe, you know, something to look at, those two here in the next few weeks when we get around the state championship time.
Yeah, I've seen Kennett wrestle. He's an outstanding wrestler for Walker Valley.
He's a beast, there's no doubt.
Yeah, congratulations to him. Look for big things from him once we get into state time. And then, of course, my favorite weight class, the heavyweights, 285. Shut up, Chris. John Simpson for Cleveland gets a decision over Walker Valley. Hey, I like to watch the big guys go at it. You can keep the little guys, you know, flying all over the mat. I want to see the big bulls, you know, go. It's fun. When's the last time you were at a wrestling match? You still thought they used steel chairs the other day.
No. That's your kind of wrestling.
It is. And then the other wrestling match was Bradley, Soddy Daisy. Bradley won 51-17. I'm not going to go through it. It'd be easier to tell me who won for Walker or for Soddy, but
in that situation, though, what was the score again?
51-17.
You're talking about the number one team in the state versus the number four team in the state.
Right.
Not number 14, not number 24, but the fourth-ranked team in the state. And Bradley just completely dominated.
Yeah, I think this year, Soddy's a little bit down. Walker Valley, unfortunately, is a little bit down. I really
did you say
see
the number three team in the state is down.
I mean, I know it's sorry, but
it may just be that Cleveland and Bradley have separated themselves from the rest of the area.
Well, and of course,
Even though the rankings are somewhat similar.
Yeah, and I say down compared to Bradley and Cleveland, because the unfortunate thing is only two of these teams can go to state, and I think without a shadow of a doubt, it's going to be Bradley and Cleveland.
Unless something just drastically different happens,
hey,
I think you're right there.
That's why you play the game.
Right. But now here's what's going to happen that has happened years past that I don't like. Bradley will go in as a one seed. Cleveland will go in as a two seed. And if they get to the finals, they won't wrestle. Cleveland will forfeit. It's been traditional that the number two team will take a forfeit and so that they can both go on so that they don't get anybody hurt. I don't like that. Wrestle the match. And it's going to be interesting to see. Last year it happened. The two seed forfeited the match, wasn't it? Was it Bradley that forfeited to Cleveland?
I believe so.
And let's see if Cleveland returns the favor this year. I'm saying Cleveland go ahead and wrestle the match. I want to see him wrestle.
So we've talked off air about this, about my feelings on some of the, you know, state tournament, how they're handled in Tennessee. So I won't speak to the forfeit yet, but I'll read up on it for next week because I have, like we talked about boys basketball, boys and girls basketball, I had concerns about you're in some sort of tournament play after the regular season, and then, you know, you can possibly lose and still continue on. You still have a chance for the state championship after you lose at that point. And if it sounds like wrestling
is – situation, though, not just losing the tournament, but, I mean, it's losing in the championship game –
well,
which the number one and number two move on.
No, and I understand that with wrestling and there's some other sports, you know, you finish in the top so many and you move on to the next, you know, whether it be, I think you guys say sub-state, you know, or state, stuff like that. I'm saying for the finite sports like basketball, you know, if you lose a game once a tournament starts, right, I think you should be out.
Well, not everyone else is a Hoosier purist like yourself. So
I do come from the greatest state for basketball, at least high school basketball, which would be Indiana.
Eight of the largest high school arenas are in the state of Indiana.
And my hometown, Newcastle, Indiana, actually has the largest high school gymnasium in the entire world.
And
look it up.
8,000 people in the town, and the
look
gym
it up.
Seats
you're probably not going to believe me because you wouldn't believe anyone unless you actually been to the gym like Danny
it's
and Brian.
Beautiful.
Have, so.
I mean, it's like a college. You walk in. The upper level and stuff.
I'm a purist when it comes to the sense of once tournament play starts
you're saying you should be out once you lose, but down here it's the top two from district go on to region, top two from region go on to sub-state. Then once you get in the sub-state, then it's you lose, you go home.
Oh, okay.
It's not.
What, so it's like, I mean, you could lose twice and still win the state championship.
I know what you're saying.
You still could, but.
Tennessee would not want, if you've ever seen the movie Hoosiers, Tennessee does not believe in the dream team like Milan.
No.
It couldn't happen here, right?
Does Indiana believe in it anymore?
They don't.
Of course, for people that don't know what we're talking about, Indiana basketball used to be you took every school in the state and put them in. There was no classification. There was no quad A, triple A, double A. You put every team in the state in one massive tournament, and whoever came out, and that's what the movie Hoosiers is based on. A little school. It wasn't really Milan, or it was Milan. It wasn't Hickory. It was Milan.
Yeah, it was Milan.
Indiana
won
against, I think it was a team from Indianapolis.
Ben
Davis.
Great story.
So it's a good story. And now that Indiana's gone to class basketball, although they've gone to class basketball like every other state now, still, if once the tournament starts, if you lose, you're out. So, you know, it's. I'm just a purist when it comes to that. I hate that Indiana got rid of the one class system and went to multiple classes, so they could crown five state championships.
All right, so let me pull us back to where we're.
I've been on a rant for 2 weeks.
Similar to those Detroit Lions rant, wasn't it?
So I believe there's 14 weight classifications in the state. Cleveland and Bradley have 9. Either number one or number two.
And don't forget when we get into wrestling, there's a couple different state titles you can win. You've got your individual,
right?
Then you've got your team, and then you've got your traditional team, which is like, you know, Bradley against Cleveland. So there's actually three. You know, you win, you get team standings, total points was one state championship, then you've got your traditional team format, and then you've got your individual. So wrestling is huge. And of course, that will all be held out towards isn't Tennessee Tech around that area that hosts that every year?
Cookeville, because you know, we talked about last week, obviously, you know, Bradley, 22 state champions, 52 individual state champions, Cleveland with back-to-back state champions here in the past couple of years, Walker Valley with their first state champion medalist just 2 years ago. So a lot of wrestling tradition, both from Bradley and Cleveland, Walker Valley, Coach Morris trying to get that team up. Last year, I believe they may be up a little bit more than what they are now this year. But as you said, Chris, you still have to wrestle the match, if you will.
It'll be exciting to see, you know, what we expect doesn't always happen. That happened 1,000 times, it seemed like, during football season, except for Danny's predictions.
Right. Any idea Brian on who's hosting the wrestling district this year? Walker Valley had it last year.
I have to look at it and see.
I can't remember.
Sure,
I'm wondering if it's Ottawa, but I don't think the same one would do wrestling and basketball. So we'll check on that and get back. Real quick, before you take another break, you wanted to talk some bowling.
Yes, some bowling. Walker Valley Lady Mustangs, congratulations to them. Still undefeated, 25-0. They'll be heading to Smyrna Thursday night where they'll start the state tournament for their state championship bid, if you will.
Yeah, good luck.
They beat Oakland 19-8 this week. Alexis Rutledge bowling a 560 series, and Angel Davis bowling a 517 series. So good luck to the Lady Mustangs. They're already in the state championship rounds of bowling. Mustangs are number two, and they will bowl number one, Columbia Central, Monday night. And the winner of that game, how you get the number one versus the number two to go to the state championship, I don't know. But congratulations to Lady Mustangs, and good luck to the Mustangs bowling Monday night.
All right, let's go ahead and, by the way, real quick before we go break,
thanks,
Jay.
Jay
pulls up the a picture. There is Newcastle's basketball arena. Seats 10,000 people with the extra bleachers they can bring in from the top. Look at that.
Yeah, so this would be where I was sitting watching the games after I was cut from the basketball team.
On the first day.
No, come on. Give me the last day at least.
That is a great arena.
Okay, so now with this picture and speaking of what, you know, because we have, and that's the one thing I know people don't, you know, they say, well, no, no, we're not from Cleveland, but we got here as fast as we could, okay? We love sports. The three of us have been around sports our entire lives. We've, you know, everywhere from the West Coast, to East Coast, and everywhere in between, we've been football games, basketball games, baseball, softball, you know, pretty much every type of sport, we've either attempted it or talked about it. The one thing that I would love to happen is for someone like, I don't know, let's say right now, the Cleveland High School, I wish they would talk to some of the fans before they just finish the building of the complex. Just simply because, for the fact, and no offense, Walker Valley, if someone would have asked, hey, how should we build this basketball gym? I guarantee you, one of us would have said, put more than 30 seats on the opposite side.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Some of the places around here, just, you know, the parking for one thing, the concession stands, the restrooms, it's not fan friendly. And I know you have to worry about the cost conscious standpoint up front, but then looking down the road at the long haul,
hey, before it's built, let's go, Cleveland. Come on, Alan Jones, let's go. Let's build the second largest high school arena in the world. So let's go. Come on, let's go on that.
Not the largest. We're not
building. No, we want second largest. I want. That's the only thing Newcastle has. Let me keep that, please.
You're banned from Newcastle.
You'll shatter
now.
The town's dreams if you build that. Let's take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll talk about the college football national championship game. We'll talk about a little pro football. So stick with us on WTNB Sports.
The Flooring Center of Cleveland, Tennessee has been providing our community with personal service and competitive pricing for over 15 years. Carpet, hardwood, tile, ceramic, and vinyl options are all in stock with plenty of top quality brand names. From 8 to 5 Monday through Friday and 9 to 2 on Saturday, our knowledgeable staff are here to help you with your flooring decisions. Come on down and visit our showroom today.
What can I say about the Little Diner on First? Well, they start the morning off right with fresh cooked food. And boy, you can really taste the difference. The Little Diner on First will satisfy your appetite with home-style cooking that you crave. It'll be like you never left the house. Remember, in a world where everything is big, sometimes it's okay to think small.
Town Americana, where trucks are big and bold, and a handshake is firm, and your word is gold. Don Lefford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens is a $2,000 drive. Maybe you're coming from here or here. Doesn't matter. Buying a truck from Don Lefford in Athens will save you at least $2,000. Don Lefford Chevy Buick GMC in Athens, a $2,000 drive worth making.
I'll take that drive every time.
What sets MaidPro apart from other cleaning companies? Well, for starters, we're pros. So we're pro scrubbing, dusting, shining. We're pro kid and pet friendly. We're pro doing things your way, like not touching your messy desk. We're pro neat freak. We're pro affordable and pro Monday afternoons because that time was just right for you. In short, MaidPro is pro you. MaidPro, because your standards aren't standard.
Thank you.
Welcome back. WTNB Sports, Danny Bradley, along with Brian Russell and Chris Woods. And Chris, do we have some people to thank before we go anywhere?
We do. WTNB Sports is presented by XLIX of Cleveland. As you can see, behind Brian's huge noggin there, XLIX of Cleveland, 1107 South Lee Highway, Cleveland, Tennessee, 423-559-2668. Or you can visit their website at linexofclevelandtn.com.
Do great work. Go visit them.
Also, we'd like to thank the following show sponsors. As you can see, LED Gear, LED-gear.com.
Hey, I just noticed that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have some, where you been? We have some new
signage. They do our new, great lighting.
New signage.
That's nice.
Do the Vanna White here.
And he'd make a great police detective.
Yeah.
I just noticed a dead body there.
As always, we'd like to thank Ed Jacobson Associates, Logan Thompson Law, which is you can visit them at loganthompsonlaw.com. Also, Trace Hermanos, check out the tacos there. They have specials during the week, too.
Love
that. And they have a great sign out front that tells you all the specials that they have during the week. Keystone Solutions IT, Kyle Motors, RPM Transport, and Marco's Pizza.
Does Trace Hermanos have our picture there?
I don't know. They seem to know my name every time I go in there. And so Marco's too, man. Great, great food. So, all right, national championship game last week. A little bit of a disappointment from pick-wise from us three. None of us got that game right. All three of us said Oregon. But, I mean, really, did anybody anticipate Ohio State going on this kind of a run with a third-string quarterback?
No, and I think Zeke Elliott is the one who carried Ohio State through the – three games.
He needs to learn how to wear a football shirt.
If you have somebody that runs for 200 yards a game in the Big Ten Championship, first round of the college football playoffs, and the championship game, then clearly, you know, it's going to open up things down the field in the passing game, yeah. Right? Yeah. And that's exactly what happened. Cardale Jones can step back and throw a 50-yard bomb with, it looks like, little effort.
So here's number one on my list. There will be a quarterback controversy starting for Ohio State.
Starting now. Yeah. Starting now.
Well, of course, Miller, I think, is going to transfer, but that still leaves Cardale Jones.
But he hasn't said that yet.
No.
No, but I mean, everybody's pretty much saying, when JT Miller. Barrett came in and played so well, everybody said Miller's gone.
So the thing about Miller is, so I was reading some articles this week, too, is, one, Miller, the thing about him not transferring, why I don't think he will transfer, is because he can't even start throwing until the summer, I believe, right? So he can't go through spring practice throwing a football. Yeah. So if he was to transfer, first of all, he's not going to start off at a new school until...
He's going to transfer and sit.
Yeah,
yeah.
So, I don't think he'll do that. I really don't. Because everybody thinks that he doesn't really have the skills that will take him to the next level in the pros as a quarterback. However... They said he's got great quickness, like open field, like you don't want to try to tackle him in the open field.
Mm-hmm. So you're thinking possibly a switch to wide receiver?
Yeah,
maybe?
To wide receiver, which is exactly Green Bay's, I'm going to forget his name.
Gordy Nelson?
No.
No, I know who you're thinking about that, Randall Cobb.
Yeah, Randall Cobb was a college quarterback.
Right, for University of Kentucky.
Yeah, and he actually switched to wide receiver because he would have a better chance in the NFL.
Okay, so assuming Miller does that, then you're left with JT Barrett.
Yeah, we're talking about multiple seasons with him having shoulder issues too, right?
Jones, yeah.
Major issues. So I say, why not? Why not take yourself out of that controversy? You guarantee, not guarantee, but... Urban Meyer knows how to develop NFL players.
If you're an athlete, you know you're going to be on the field.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, JT Barrett, Cardale Jones go in. Who wins the starting job? Or is there? Because don't forget, Urban Meyer loves to use that two-quarterback system. At Florida, had Chris Leak and Tim Tebow. Do you use both quarterbacks throughout the year?
I see. Me, personally, I start Cardale next year as long as, it's close through spring practices. And then what I would – because – he's got one less year than JT Barrett does, right? So Cardale, if he has one more great year, then he could change his stance on that he absolutely wants to finish school first. Wins a Heisman, win another national championship. He could,
or at least vie for another national championship.
And this year, I understand it. He said all the right things at the press conference, as far as education comes first. I don't know him, so I'd have to believe him. Although he did send out a tweet that said, why do we even have to go to classes?
Right, I was going
to
say, this is the same guy that said that a couple years ago.
He was probably 18 years old at the time. Come on, I did all sorts of stuff at 18 that I would not want on the internet.
But you didn't put it on the internet either, did you?
But no, what
no, because nobody was putting anything on the internet.
Okay,
at that
so talking
time.
About the decision, Danny, good move or bad move to come back?
Good news for Ohio State.
But for him personally.
For him personally, I think you've got to cash the check when it's coming.
Because they were saying if he had come out, he was probably going to be a third or fourth round pick, looking at making probably $500,000 in the pros, or possibly come back, improve your draft status, but also risk
injury. When you say improve your draft status, I mean, take a look at
first round pick.
Right, and that's what I'm saying. Take a look at any of the quarterbacks that's been drafted lately in the NFL. They're not drafting quarterbacks 1 and 2 anymore.
Right.
Because they can't prove themselves.
Well, they will this year. Yeah, they're going to draft two quarterbacks, 1 and 2 this year, with Mariota and Jameis Winston, who, and I wouldn't take either one in the top five, but that's what they do, right? If you need a quarterback, if you think you need a quarterback, they just take the quarterback. Okay. They do.
Do you think
it's a big splash?
They will be the number one, number two?
I think one of them will be number one. I believe the other one will go in the top five.
See,
definitely.
I think the team's going to downdraft, and then they'll be taken later, and there'll be a team that needs a bigger need.
There's a bunch of bad
teams. I think one of them does go one. I think you're right. And I think if it's Winston, then I think Mariota falls possibly a 5 or 6 where I think the Eagles try to trade up to get him because, of course, it's Chip Kelly. Very familiar with the Oregon offense. That's what they're saying.
Yeah.
But I don't think either one of them is going to be a star in the pros. I just don't. And I think Cardale Jones, I think he did make the right decision because now everybody's like, well, what if he gets hurt? You buy insurance. These athletes have insurance nowadays.
That's right. That's what I was going to say.
You know, you're guaranteed the money. Look at what's the running back for Georgia? Gurley. He has insurance on him.
Yeah.
Knee injury, if he drops out of the first round, he's still making $3 million. I mean, so the risk of injury anymore is slim to you.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter to these guys.
And I actually think that's a good thing because it doesn't make some of these kids, like, absolutely jump the money like we were talking about, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you flash $500,000 in front of me right now, and I'll probably say, okay. What do I have to skip? But if you ask me that at 20 years old or 19 years old, then I would, probably say do it. But long term, even if he gets through this year, safe,
mm-hmm.
I don't think that he's going to be downgraded. I mean, I can't see Ohio State or him with those weapons having a horrible, horrible year, you know.
Yeah.
So if he gets through the season, I think his draft status, the reason we wouldn't even be talking about him not going into the draft had he played another season, right?
Right.
Had he had 10 starts under his belt. But, he was only a third-round pick or late second round because he'd only started 3 games high school, right?
The only thing he risked by playing another year is there's more game film on him. NFL scouts are going to be able to break down his throwing motion like they did with Tebow. But unless he's got something just outrageous, some outrageous flaw in his throwing motion – any NFL team's going to look at him and go, I can work with that. 6'4", 250. We can work with that.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting. I think Ohio State goes with the two quarterback system. Another thing to talk about is a new ruling that just happened. The Power 5 conferences voted and are now going to be able to pay student athletes, make up for, I think it's anywhere between $2,000 and $4,000 to assist with cost of living that scholarships don't cover. Good or bad move?
When you have a regular,
I love putting them on the spot.
Well, when you have a regular student at school somewhere already that's not an athlete, and they're having to go to class and they don't get their free meal plan, they don't get as many meals as they can eat in a week, and they don't have the free clothes, the free food, the free tickets to, I think it's going to happen anyway. Mm-hmm. I think it's been happening anyway for the top-notch college athletes.
Right.
What's going to happen with someone now, though, when you're talking about this, you know, your 11th and 12th man on the roster, if you will, on a basketball team, let's say.
Exactly.
What's going to happen to them? Are they going to get the $3,000 a year that you're allotting for your star point guard that's averaging 26 points a game and 10 assists? Someone that's averaging, you know, less than a minute a game on sitting on the end of the bench? Are they going to be treated the exact same as you treat your number one player? If that's the case, then yes, I'm right. for it. I don't think it's going to happen. I really don't
buy the fact that now everybody's saying, oh, well, this solves all the problems. Now nobody's going to pay these athletes. I think it just opens up, and I can see both sides of the story. I think it just opens up for issues exactly like that. Oh, well, so-and-so is getting $3,000. Well, we need a good backup point guard, so here come the boosters. Hey, we'll get you that money. Don't worry. We'll get you that money on the table. I don't think it solves all the problems, but I can see both sides.
I don't think they'll have some of those issues anymore, because I think what they're trying to do is get away from, well, if this kid wants to go to, I'll just throw out some names, like if he wants to go to Auburn, you know, but Alabama, booster, and I'm just using these schools, like.
just happened to
you know, if a booster was going to pay him $5,000, now they can say, well, school A, you know, is offering scholarships, and they are offering the stipend where you can make, you know, $4,000 a year or semester. You know, now it's legal or within the rules of at least the Power Five conferences to do so. What I don't like is it's just going to separate from the Power Five conferences to the rest of the conferences.
What happens to everybody else?
Well, they don't care. That's what they want, though. The Power Five conferences would like to separate themselves from the rest of
So no more
colleges.
No more MAC competing for anything. No more Conference USA. All these schools are going to be left behind. I don't know if that's necessarily a good thing.
I don't think it is. I think getting – okay. So I think the NCAA kind of caused this because they were using likenesses of athletes. They were using – you know, I don't know if you guys saw this, but NCAA, they took down the Jersey website, right?
Right.
Because I think it said, like, did it say Johnny Football on the back,
yeah.
I think? It didn't say Manziel, but it said Johnny Football on the back or something like
that.
Well,
like everybody knew when you were playing a game, everybody knew you were Tim Tebow.
Right.
Tim
you know, Tebow. When I went to school and after I graduated, you go back to Purdue and you'd see Drew Brees numbers and stuff like that. Everybody knew they were Drew Brees numbers, right? That's why.
Everybody knew who it was.
Yeah, everybody knows who it is. Right. So I don't agree with some of that, especially them like going right up to the line and leaning over the morality line there of, you know, whether you're using these kids like the video games and stuff like that. I don't think they should be able to do that. Right. Have it general. Right. General teams. Purdue University, a team. But don't make the athletes look exactly nowadays. Graphics is so great.
Yeah.
Don't make the athletes look exactly like the athletes that were on the team last year that won the national championship, something like that.
My only thing with this, and I haven't probably done as much research on it as I should have, but now that we're coming, let's give the NCAA basketball tournament. Now, are we going to end up having to have two tournaments? Because the Power Five conferences are going to be able to pay their athletes, and they're all going to be better than
the basketball tournament.
This is what's going to happen. Let's go back to the days when NCAA was actually the, you know, NCAA,
they actually
harsh. No. I'm saying when they went against, you're going to get someone like me, a Jerry Tarkanian, that comes up and says, okay, SEC, ACC, you know, whomever, Big Ten, I'll get five or six junior college players that are on the cusp of being, you know, either in prison or playing basketball or out of school completely, but great basketball players that none of these big schools would touch. Because there just was, you know, you've got so many great athletes. Yeah. That was Tarkanian's thing. Remember, when he come in, he took a bunch of junior college players, and that was one of the greatest basketball minds I have ever been able to talk with, sit down, and spend time with. I got to go to UNLV and watch, you know, when Larry Johnson and Stacey Alderman, all of them ran through the NCAA like that. Everyone else was standing still. And Tarkanian took the brunt of NCAA's blow after blow after blow. You're going to have coaches that are going to, you know, try to get those players that are, you know, just on the outside of those big, you know, the big five, if you will, conferences. And they're going to make a run for the money. Basketball is probably the one sport that you can take any team at any night and win.
Yeah.
Football is a little bit different.
I agree.
Football, you know,
Yeah, and you got a smaller team, too. Basketball is easier because you have a smaller team.
But
so
still,
you can
how do you convince those kids to come to that school when they can go to North Carolina and get
there?
They have
to
want them to come there.
There's still going
to
be the same number of scholarships, right? I'm not saying that. I'm just saying nowadays there are situations where students will choose, you know, a MAC school or a Big West school versus – or Mountain West school, sorry, versus going to an SEC team. You know, if that's maybe their home school or their parents went there, things like that. Now, that just gives a little bit more leverage if some of these Power 5 teams do agree to, you know, now that they can, do agree to give a kid $4,000. If you're torn between two schools, Nanny, right? And, you know, one is maybe emotional, like I'm kind of leaning that way, and you would. But now, this school B, which is an SEC school, you may not necessarily want to go to, but now they can offer you so much money
that's
per semester, too.
Well, you know, but you go back to like Randy Moss. He didn't want to go to West Virginia because he wanted to get out of his state.
Yeah.
He wanted to go somewhere to be different.
Yeah.
You know, West Virginia would have offered him a scholarship, would have paid for him, you know.
Yeah.
But you're going to have kids making decisions that, you know, we're sitting here saying it's going to fall, you know, this square peg is going to fall here, this round peg is going to. It's not always going to be as simple as it
No, it's not, but I think it's the power shift. I think it's going to affect them, but we'll have to wait and see. Talk. We only got a couple minutes left. Let's talk about a little pro football. We just watched the end of, you know, of course this show will be aired later, but we just watched the end of the Green Bay-Seattle game. Crazy ending in that one. Seattle wins in overtime, goes down, scores a touchdown. Patriots right now in control over the Colts, so let's just assume it's Seattle and New England. Chris, who do you like? I mean, two teams I can't stand. So.
I'll go with the Seahawks and kind of in hopes that whether it's the Patriots or if somehow Indy comes back that they would win. But I'll go with the Seahawks because they just seem to pull it out. I'm so jealous of the Seahawks right now because, you know, there's only the – and the Patriots have been this way in years past, especially when they were on their Super Bowl run, where you get a team that – like, they can be down 17 points, 16 points. You know, they play terrible, and you're thinking, my Lions, the Detroit Lions, would fold. Like, there's no chance we're going to come back against a really, really good team and somehow pull it out at the end. And, you know, in a big, big game, especially like a playoff game. So I'm jealous.
So you got Seattle.
I'm saying Seattle. Yeah. Seattle is that team.
As much as it pains me, I'm going to go the other way and take the Patriots.
Okay.
Just simply because I think Brady's on his goodbye tour. We'll see.
Yeah.
But they've just been dominating.
Yeah. For me personally, yeah, I throw up in my mouth every time I say these two teams' names. My two least favorite teams in the NFL. I can't pick against Bill Belichick and Tom Brady. They've done it too many times. Brady is nearing the end of his career, not done yet, but nearing the end of his career. I think Bill Belichick is hands down, and this pains me to say, the best X's and O's coach in the National Football League. And if you don't think, as a Seattle fan or a football fan, that he's going to find a way to take advantage of the matchups, and everybody's going to say, oh, well, Richard Sherman's just going to shut down their number one receiver. If you don't think Bill Belichick's going to have an answer for Richard Sherman in that defense, you're crazy.
Yeah, but here's the thing.
The answer.
Who's that number one receiver for the Patriots?
Exactly. They
Brandon,
don't have
Brandon
one.
LaFell.
Yeah, names.
Thank you.
Edelman. Side note, too, we'll see if Richard Sherman plays, but
he badly
injured his arm where he could not even run with his arm to his side today. So.
I think Belichick finds a way to win that. So we'll say if the Colts somehow pull off the upset next week, we'll change our picks and all that. So. That's another show in the books. Thank you for watching WTNB Sports. Again, thank you to Line X of Cleveland, LED Gear. We'll see you back here next week. Same bat time, same bat
Visit
channel.
Our Facebook page, Twitter.
Leave us comments. We'll answer them.